Good afternoon, student. Today we will see the virology section of microbiology. So in the virology, we will start with the lecture of general properties of the viruses. So today we will see at the end of this session, the morphology and nomenclature of the viruses, which this lecture includes only morphology and varieties of classification of the viruses. The other parts of laboratory diagnosis, the viral host interaction, treatment and immunoprophylaxis will be covered in a next lectures. So, viruses. As you know that the viruses, which is the smallest unicellular organism, and they are obligate intracellular organism. So, here the word obligate intracellular means they always remain inside the cells. The viruses are the most primitive microorganism infecting a man. So these all are the general properties of the virus. They are the obligate intracellular organism. They possesses either DNA or RNA, but never both. So they are smaller than the bacteria. So that's why they can easily pass through the variety of the filters. They cannot be grown on artificial cell culture media. Like we cannot grow these viruses on a blood agar, McConkie agar, chocolate agar. But here we require animals, embryonated eggs or tissue cultures. The viruses are differs from bacteria and other prokaryotes by they multiply by a complex method. Like in a bacteria, some are divided by a binary fission, but here there is a multiplication is a different way. They do not have a proper cellular organization. It means they do not have a organization like a ribosomes, mesosome, as you have seen in a bacteria. They do not have a cell wall or cell membrane or cellular organelles including ribosomes. They lack the enzymes which are necessary for the proteins and nucleic acid synthesis. So they have to depend on the host cell. They are not susceptible to antibacterial antibiotics. Morphology of the viruses. See, the viruses which includes the different structure inside the cell. First, we will see the nucleic acid. The nucleic acid in the virus may be single or double-stranded, circular or linear, segmented or unsegmented. First, what is the meaning of single and double-stranded? There are one strand of a genetic copy or double strand of genetic copies. The shape of this double-stranded or single-stranded genetic copies is circular or it may be linear. Segmented or unsegmented, it means there are some segments which are present on these strands. So they are viruses where we will see in the next classification slide, where some viruses which are segmented, like a rotavirus, which is a segmented virus, like influenza viruses, which is having 8 segments in their strands. Viruses are classified based on the nucleic acid. So we always classified virus either DNA virus or RNA viruses. Now the outer layer of this nucleic acid, the nucleic acid which is inside the capsid. So this capsid which is act as a protective layer for the nucleic acid. They compose of number of repeated protein subunits, polypeptide. It is called the capsomere. So capsid which is made up of variety of the protein subunits, capsomere. So what is the function of this capsid? As I said that earlier, it protects the nucleic acid core from the external environment. In a non-enveloped viruses, there are two types of viruses, enveloped and non-enveloped. The non-enveloped virus having a it does not having a outer covering. And in envelope virus, they having a outer covering. We will see in the next slide what is the outer covering. In the non-envelope virus, they initiate the first step of viral replication. So here what will happen, the nucleic acid which is surrounded by a capsid. So this capsid is only the bind to the host cell membrane, and just DNA or RNA structure which will goes inside the cells. So this capsid also having a antigenic and specific for the each virus. So the here there is a antigens which are present, and which is a where it is a different species specific antigens are present. Now the next is symmetry. It is symmetry means according to arrangement of the capsomere. So you can see in this picture, this is the one type. There are three types of symmetry: icosahedral, helical and complex. Here the structure, this diagram which showing the this icosahedral symmetry, it means you can see this is the virus outer covering envelope, and this is the inner covering capsid. So this is the ultra structure of this capsid. Capsid which is made up of capsomere, and this inside this capsid there is a nucleic acid structure. So you can see this shape of this structure. This is the icosahedral symmetry structure. And the capsomere which are arranged as if they lay on a faces of an icosahedron. So you, there are 20 triangles. Here it is a one triangle. Then here it is a two triangle. So there are 20 triangular facets and 12 corners or vertices in this icosahedral symmetry virus. And this structure is very rigid. So almost all DNA viruses and most of the RNA virus having this type of icosahedral symmetry. There is a one exception in DNA viruses, smallpox virus or pox virus, which having a complex symmetry. Now next is helical symmetry. Helical means there is a helical like structure. This is the hollow structure. So nucleic acid which is inside this capsomere, helical capsomere. And in the cross section of this helical structure which is look like this. Okay, this is in a round form. This capsomere are coiled surrounding the nucleic acid in the form of helix or spiral. Like a spirochete bacteria, they are forming a spirals inside the capsomere. So they are flexible structure. And some RNA viruses having this type of helical symmetry. The example of this helical symmetry viruses are myxovirus, rhabdovirus, filovirus or bunia virus. So these all four are the RNA containing viruses. And the third one, symmetry, is complex symmetry. Means they do not have either this helical or icosahedral symmetry. So this is the complex symmetry. And only one DNA virus is, that is a pox virus, having this type of complex symmetry. Now the next structure of this virus is envelope. Envelope which is the outermost covering of the viruses, and it is surrounding this nucleocapsid. Nucleic acid along with the capsomere, along with the capsid, which is known as a nucleocapsid, and surrounding this nucleocapsid, there is an outer envelope is present. And this envelope which is made up of lipoprotein, lipid and protein combinations. Here there is a what will happen, the lipid part as you show in a diagram, this all this yellow portion is the lipid outer layer. So this lipid part which is derived from the host cell membrane, what will happen in their life cycle when they are released from the host cell? They are obligate intracellular organisms. So whenever after the lysis of this host cell, some portion of this host cells like a lipid portion, they help for forming of this outer envelope. So this lipid portion which is derived from the host cells, but this protein part which is made up, which is very antigenic in nature, this is the virus coded. It means they are derived from the virus itself, and it is a made up of subunit proteins which is known as a papillomeres, as it is mentioned in the diagram. This green color dotted are the papillomeres. These papillomeres are the project as a spikes on the surface of the envelope, and this envelope more susceptible to the heat and lipid solvent like ether, and it has having a antigenic property which facilitate the entry of the viruses. So they help in the adhesion of to the host cells and entry of the viruses inside nucleic acid inside the host cell. More than one kind of papillomer can be seen in some viruses, like influenza viruses having a neuraminidase and hemagglutinin papillomere. There are two types of papillomeres are present in the influenza viruses. Most viruses are enveloped viruses, but there are some exceptions are there. They having a non-envelope. They do not having any envelope. So this non-envelope viruses, which are very much dangerous because they are not susceptible to the ether or any lipid solvent. So example of this non-envelope viruses, in case of DNA viruses, parvovirus, papillomavirus and adenovirus. And in case of the RNA viruses, there are some examples like a picornaviruses, hepatitis A and E, then rhinoviruses, then estroviruses. Okay. Now the size of the viruses. This is important for your knowledge. Like some viruses are very small in size, so that is why they are very much easily passed through these filters, variety of different size filters. So you can see in this figure, there are smallest virus, which is a parvovirus, having a 18 to 26 nanometer of the size. And in contrast to smallpox virus, pox virus, which is the largest viruses in the family. So this smallpox virus is having this dumbbell shape capsid inside the cell, inside their envelope. Okay, so this is also known as a brick shaped viruses. Then next is the rhabdovirus, which causing a rabies. The shape of this rhabdovirus is like a bullet shape, right? Then this is the herpes viruses. Then influenza viruses. Here you can see there is a two type of spikes are present. One is hemagglutinin and another is neuraminidase spikes. This structure is showing the bacteriophage. Okay, and this is the adenovirus. Adenovirus structure, which is look like some space vehicle. So structure of this adenovirus, and this the smallest one, which is a parvovirus. Because of the small viruses, virus can pass through the bacterial filter and they cannot be visualized under the light microscope. The size of the virus can be measured by different types of methods, but electron microscope, which is a very useful for looking for the size of the viruses. Other methods like ultracentrifugation, here what we have to do, the viral particles which are suspended into the liquid medium, and they are subjected for the ultracentrifugation, and they will settle down at the sedimentation rate which is proportional to their size. So that if there is a larger cell virus size, they can easily sediment in the test tube. Then passage through the membrane filter. There are different pore size of the membrane filters are available. So according to their pore size, these pores prevent the viruses to pass through these filters. So at that which number the filters are able to, they are not able to pass from this. So this is the size of the filter and size of the viruses. So this is the nomenclature and classification of the viruses. That as I said earlier, there are two type of virus, DNA virus and RNA virus. Okay, first we will see the DNA viruses. In the DNA viruses, there are five types of DNA viruses: herpes viridae, hepatitis viridae, parvo, papova, pox viridae and adenoviridae. So this herpes viridae, which is the largest family in the DNA viruses, as it having a double stranded linear type of the DNA structures, And in this all five types variety, only the parvovirus having a single stranded DNA structure. So here there is a strand of the DNA which is a single. All the viruses in the DNA viruses, only three virus which having a non-envelope, they are the parvo, papova and adenovirus. Then symmetry, all the having a icosahedron symmetry, but one is exception, there is a pox viridae. They're having a complex symmetry. So this is the family of this herpes viridae, which includes a 1 to 8 herpes virus infection. Human herpes HHV 1 to HHV 8. So in the third one, varicella zoster, then Epstein-Barr virus, cytomegalovirus, human herpes virus 6, 7 and 8. Then in hepatoviridae family, only hepatitis B is there, parvovirus, which includes the parvovirus B19. Then papovaviridae, which includes the papilloma and polyoma virus. So human papilloma, JC and BK virus. The pox viridae, which includes the pox variola, vaccinia and molluscum contagiosum virus. Adenoviridae, which includes human adenovirus. This is the RNA classification of the viruses. There are different types of RNA viruses family. The picornaviridae, which includes polio, coxsackie, as you very much aware about the polio viruses, coxsackie, eco, enterovirus, rhinovirus, hepatitis A virus. Then calciviridae, which includes the Norwalk and hepatitis E virus. In the RNA type of the virus, all the RNA viruses are the single-stranded RNA. But there is a one exception in the RNA virus family, that is the rhovirididae and retroviridae having a double-stranded RNA. And in case of the retroviridae, there is a two copies of the RNA which is present. And in case of rhovirididae, there is a double-stranded RNA is present. Then the envelope which is absent in case of the RNA, like in a picornavirus, then in a calcivirus, then rho, then in an astrovirus. Okay, so these are the, and then we can see the symmetry of this RNA virus, all having the icosahedral symmetry, but there is a some exception like a coronaviridae, then rhabdoviridae, phyloviridae, buniaviridae, which having a paramyxoviridae, these all having a helical symmetry. Okay, then you can see here there is a last retroviridae. They having a two identical copies of the positive signs of the RNA, but there is two copies of the RNA strand is present. And in case of the rhovirididae, there is a double stranded RNA is present. Okay, and this all the RNA virus family, they include different type of the viruses in each group. Now viral replication. Virus, as you know, that bacteria also undergo the binary fission for the multiply themselves. But in case of the virus, the multiplication and replication which is differ from the bacteria. Virus which undergo a complex way of cell division. Here there is the steps which are showing in the slide. So first step for the each and every virus having a attachment to the host cells. Then after attachment, they what will happen, the only the nucleic acid capsid portion which having a DNA or RNA material which penetrates through this host cell membrane. Then uncoating of this RNA and DNA structure. Then they start the synthesis of the different types of proteins and enzymes. Then they combine, they assemble themselves inside the host cells. Then they mature inside the host cell. And after that, they release. We will see step by step each and every replication. So first step is the attachment, which is the most specific step. It is mediated by the receptor. So specific virus having a specific type of receptors on the host cells. The virus is having attachment sites on their envelopes or a capsid protein. If there is a non-envelope virus, the capsid structure having a capacity to attach to the host cells, to the complementary sites on the host cells. Like here there is examples given in HIV virus, the viral surface glycoprotein having a GP120. This is the glycoprotein spikes which is present on the surface of the HIV virus, which binds to the CD4 molecule on the host cells. So there is a receptor already present for the GP120. Then in case of influenza virus, viral hemagglutinin envelope protein, which is bind specifically to the glycoprotein receptor present on the surface of the respiratory epithelium. Then second step is penetration. The penetration, which there are variety of the mechanism for the penetration. One is viroplexis. It is a receptor mediated endocytosis. Here what will happen? Whenever the virus which is attached to the host cells are engulfed, they producing a pseudopods like structure and engulfment of this virus inside the cells. So it is known as a receptor mediated endocytosis. The next is the membrane fusion. Some envelope viruses entered by the fusion of their envelope protein with the plasma membrane of the host cell, so that only the nucleocapsid entered into the host cell cytoplasma, whereas viral envelope which is remained outside the host cell. So here there is only the nucleocapsid which is goes inside. Then injection of the nucleic acid. Only the nucleic acid which is goes inside, not capsid or capsomere. So it is the example given here, the bacteriophage. What will happen in bacteriophage? The bacteriophage, whenever it is bind to the host cell receptors, the only the nucleic acid which is pierced into the host cell membrane and it is goes inside. After going inside the cell, host cell, the next step is uncoating themselves. Here, what will happen if there is a capsid is present? The capsid which is destroyed by the lysosomal enzymes present in the host cells. So viral capsid gets separated and the nucleic acid which is released from this capsid inside the host cell. But it is not happened in case of the only the bacteriophage. Okay, in the case of bacteriophage, only the nucleic acid goes inside and it is directly it is bind to the host cell DNA fragments. The next step is biosynthesis. Now they are started for the synthesis of different types of proteins and enzymes. So the following viral components are required to prepare a new virus. Like a nucleic acid we required, then enzymes, capsid proteins are required for the envelope of this nucleic acid, then enzymes which are required for the various stages in the viral replications, and the some regulatory proteins which are required to shut down the host cell metabolism. So these are the different sites of the nucleic acid replication whenever they entered into the host cell. But some it is a different in the DNA viruses and the RNA viruses. Always there is a DNA virus, they goes inside the host cell nucleus. They multiply inside the host cell nucleus. Okay, so DNA replication occurs in the nucleus, but some exception is that like in a pox virus, only they are multiplied and replicate themselves in the cytoplasma, even though they are the it is a DNA virus. And exactly in case of the RNA virus, always their replication occurs in the cytoplasma. But in case of orthomyxo and the retrovirus family, they are synthesized their RNA inside the nucleus. So these are the steps for the biosynthesis of the DNA viruses. You can see here there is a synthesis, first step transcription of this, then this parenteral DNA are some converted into the early messenger RNA, early proteins, then replication of this viral DNA, transcription, then translation, then this again late protein is formed, and whatever the form inside the host cell, they assemble themselves inside the cells, and the nucleocapsid along with this nucleic acid which is formed, this is the daughter virion. So how the viruses which is inside singly and they are doubled in the, inside the host cell. In the case of the RNA viruses, there are biosynthesis which is varies among the RNA virus. There are the positive and negative signs or single or double stranded. It is depend on the genomic RNA. So here there is a type. There are three, four types of positive, negative signs and the complex signs of this RNA replication. Here you can see the positive single stranded RNA. First they are converted into negative single stranded RNA. Then again they are converted into positive single stranded RNA. So they are for in between the they are the some proteins which are translated and forming the early viral protein which will help for the formation of this capsid and outer envelope. And second is the negative sense single stranded RNA. This negative sense again they are converted into positive single stranded RNA and again they are converted into negative single stranded RNA. In case of the double-stranded RNA, like in a reoviridae family, this double-stranded RNA, by the help of this RNA polymerase, they are separated from each other, negative and positive sense. Then again, negative sense, which is converted into positive, positive sense RNA, which is transcribed into the negative sense RNA. Again, they are assembled and forming a double-stranded RNA and the daughter virion, which is form. And in case of this complex structure, like in a retrovirus, there is, as I said earlier, there is a two copies of single stranded RNA. So in a case of HIV and other retrovirus, which is possessing non-segment positive sense, two copies of the single stranded RNA. So here what will happen, the positive single stranded RNA, which is converted into the DNA RNA hybrid, then digestion by the ribonuclease activity, reverse transcriptase enzyme, they are converted into single-stranded DNA. So here there is the RNA which is first converted into DNA, again double-stranded DNA, and they are transported into host cell nucleus. Then this double-stranded DNA which are bind to the host cell DNA. Okay, so host cell DNA nucleic acid which is integrated along with this viral host DNA. And again, they are released from the host cell nucleus and they are transcribed into the single-stranded RNA, two copies. And they assemble along with this viral protein and convert it into daughter virion. So here in case of retrovirus, the replication of inside the host cell, which is very much different from the other viruses. Now assembly, viral nucleic acid and proteins are packed together to form a progeny virus. And host cell, it is occurs in the host cell nucleus or cytoplasma. As I say, DNA virus which are assembled inside the nucleus except in Hepatitis and pox virus. And in case of RNA virus is assembled into the cytoplasma. The maturation following the assembly, the maturation of daughter virion which is takes place either into the nucleus or cytoplasma or in a membrane, Golgi or endoplasmic reticulum or plasma membrane. Then it is a come for the step release. How this progeny virions which is released from the host cells, it may be by the lysis or budding through the host cell membrane. In case of lysis of the host cell, the non-envelope viruses and bacteriophage which is coming out. Because there is a lysis of the host cell, so here there is no host cell membrane which is play a role for the development of the envelope. And in case of the budding, what will happen? The envelope viruses are formed because there is, in case of budding, there is a host cell membrane which is budding out along with the virus. So they acquire the outermost covering of the host cell membrane as a lipid to their envelope. So envelope which is acquired either from the plasma membrane in case of influenza virus or either it is formed from the nuclear membrane. Example in case of herpes virus. So it depends where the multiplication takes place in the cell. If there is a DNA viruses and it is multiplied inside the cytoplasma, the host cell, the outer layer of the cell membrane which is forming a lipid envelope. But in case of DNA which is multiplied inside the virus, inside the host cell nucleus, the nuclear membrane which forming a outer covering of envelope. So viral glycoprotein are then inserted into the envelope An excess of this glycoprotein are synthesized to saturate the cell receptor so that viruses will not stick to the host cell following release. So many glycoprotein which are attached on the this viruses, so they are not able to again they are stick to the host cell. So now that this is the phase of eclipse phase, it is defined as an interval between the penetration of the virus into the host cells and appearance of the first infectious progeny which is coming out as a virus particle. So this phase, during this period, virus cannot be demonstrated into the serum of the patient. So it is remain inside the host cells, and duration is 15 to 30 minutes for the bacteriophage and 15 to 30 hours for most of the animal viruses. These are the some, always there is a, in a replication, there is a some abnormality which has happened and which will lead to the some form of the virus, like some defective virus may be formed during their life cycle. One is example is incomplete viruses. It is formed as a result of defective assembly. All the viral structure which is formed inside the host cell, but there are defect in the assembly. So assembly which is not takes place properly, and the they are without any nucleic acid, so they are not infective to the other host cells. So one phenomena which is known as von Magnus phenomena, it is defective in assembly in influenza viruses which will leads to the production of progeny viral particles having a high heme agglutinin titer but low infectivity. In fact, they having a higher amount of antigenic structure like heme agglutinin, but they do not having a nucleic acid, so their infectivity is very low. Only antigens are present. Then pseudovirion, the capsid which is occasionally enclosed the host cell nucleic acid instead of the viral nucleic acid. So it is a misunderstanding of the virus, what happened, the capsid which enclosed the host cell nucleic acid. So here there is a nucleic acid, again it will become a defective. Then abortive infections, it is occurs when the virus is entered in the wrong host. So this host is it's not made for these viruses. So there is a host which is they are not non-permissive for the non-permissive cells for that viruses. So here the parent virus is normal but does not perform the some of the steps of the viral replication because there is a defective host selection. The defective viruses or dependo viruses, they are genetically defective, cannot perform all the steps of the viral replication by themselves, but they need some second helper cells. Here it is a very good example which is given, like hepatitis D virus. As we know that there are hepatitis A, B, C, D and E viruses, but in case of hepatitis D virus, which is a defective virus, they require for the support of hepatitis B virus. Then and then this hepatitis D virus is infective to the host cells. Another example is adenovirus associated satellite virus. It requires the help of the adenovirus. Defective interfering particles. Lack of the portion of their genome due to the deletion mutation, but contain the normal capsid protein. So this is the capsid protein. Here it is a normal, but some portion, some genetic portion of this nucleic acid structure, it may be defect. So required infectious homology normal virus as helper for the replication. So it may interfere with the multiplication of the homologous viruses. Viral genetic modification. As we have know that the in the case of bacteria, there may be some mutation which is occurs, some plasmid mediated mutation, some chromosomally mediated mutation. So it is also happened in case of virus. It is occurs during the every viral infection. It becomes evident only if it induces some readily observable property or leads to survival or death of the viruses. So here mutants occur spontaneously or may be induced chemically. So in presence of some substance, chemical substances, it may leads to the some genetic modification in their nucleic acids, like 5-fluorouracil, which is a drug, and or by any physical agents like a UV lights. So it will leads to the defective viral nucleic acid formation. So here there is the examples of types of mutation. One is conditional lethal mutant. It can grow only in a specific condition called the permissive condition, but it cannot be grow in other conditions. Temperature sensitive mutants, like type of the conditional lethal mutant that can grow at a low temperature but not at a higher temperature, 37 degrees Celsius. So they are known as a TS mutant, and it has been used for the preparation of the live viral vaccines. Then interaction between the viral genetic recombination. Here it is occurs between the two different but related viruses of the same family infecting the host cell simultaneously. So two viruses which are exchanging their genetic segments, nucleic acid between them, and so that the one hybrid which is formed, which is known as a recombinant viruses. So here hybrid which possesses a newer genetic structure, and it is more dangerous than the previous parental cells. So it is not found in both the parent virus, and they are genetically stable and they are able to replicate. Then one terminology which is used in case of gene reassortment. Here also the same mechanism like genetic recombination. But here what will happen, the type of recombination which is seen in segmented RNA viruses such as influenza, rotavirus, bunya, RNA viruses. I am giving one example of influenza virus. Why there is a, in every 5 to 10 years there is an antigenic drift or antigenic shift is there. The pandemic which has happened in case of influenza virus every 10 years, it is due to this genetic reassortment. When two strains of influenza virus infect the host cells, there is a gene exchange takes place between them, and RNA segment which is formed, which is very new and resulting in production of reassortment. A portion of the genome of the inactivated virus combined with that of the active virus, so that certain markers are inactivated. Inactivated virus are rescued and the progeny virus which is appeared viable. So this is the interaction between the viral gene, genetic reactivation, multiplicity reactivation. It is occurs when the many inactive viruses interact with each other in the same host cell and produce a one stable viable virus. So some defective virus, some inactive virus, so all the having a nucleic acid structures. So very good nucleic acid gene which is come and combined with the other genetic structure of the other virus, other healthy gene structure, and all the structure, genetic structure which are healthy, they are combined to each other and they are forming a very stable viruses. And this is occurs when the viruses are inactivated by the UV rays and have damages in a different genes. Thus, from the total genetic pool, the healthy gene may get combined to form a complete undamaged genome. UV radiation is no longer, that's why recommended for the production of the inactivated viral vaccine. Because in a vaccine, what we are going to do, all the defective virus, we are combining their genetic structure, they are combining, but what will happen, and they are undergoing this UV irradiation, but inside the vial, all the abnormal genes, they are combined to each other and they are forming a very good healthy viral genome. The several mechanism may be responsible for the viral interface, like a first virus may inhibit the entry of the second viruses. So this is the blocking by the blocking the host cell receptor, like in case of retrovirus or an enterovirus, destroying the host cell receptors like influenza virus by producing the neuraminidase. So first virus may compete with the other second virus, and they are not allowing the second virus to bind to the receptors. Here there is a examples of this polio virus. So in case of oral polio virus, they containing the three live attenuated serotypes of this polio virus. So this OPV serotypes, they interfere with the spread of the wild polio virus, SARS play a crucial role for the control of the polio outbreaks. In the next session, we will see in the viral host interaction. Today we are completing this morphology and nomenclature of the viruses and the, all the general properties, different structure of the viruses and viral different types of defective virus which is formed due to the viral replication. So here we are ending with this general properties of the virus. In the next session we will see the laboratory diagnosis and viral host interaction. Thank you.